Red.
It's because Josh wants to eat.
Yes. So can you just point it at Red and Alex will, like, stuff my face?
I don't know. If you just like this, you can, like, move around and stuff. I don't know.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I get you.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
I appreciate it.
Anything else?
I think we're great. Thank you.
Aside from, like, obviously what we know, but for our audience members, how did you guys start? Like, where did Radical Something start and continue on to this point?
Yeah, so the real inception of Rad was me and Mikey start. We played on the football team together in college. When we graduated, we decided we were going to see if we could make music work. And we went to New York City to record some songs. And this guy came into the studio super late night one time, and Mikey had been working on a beat, and that became our first song, Be Easy. And it was just like, you know, that when you walk into a room and you realize just stuff just started clicking, and it was pretty obvious. It wasn't like, it wasn't forced. It was regular, yeah.
Shout out to How I Got Through Junior
Year. Honestly.
Shout out to Junior.
Yeah, and we actually got in the studio that same night together because a mutual friend, Alex Mitchell Hart, who later became our manager, was like, hey, these kids are coming from California. You should go in the studio with them. And I remember... I'll never forget the night that he introduced us, and then we got the band going, and it was going for a little bit, and we were all, we were doing some shows in Italy, and Mikey and I were up at like 4 a.m, and we were like, Alex Mitchell Hart should manage us, and we were like, I think he did, because he worked in like corporate, he had a big corporate job, and we were like, there's no way he'll do it, you know, and then we like asked him, and he said no, and then he came back later, and was like, okay, I'll do it, and quit his job, and full-time Rad with us.
I specifically remember waiting in line for the Louvre in France and talking with Mikey about making Alex our manager. I have a vivid memory of that. Nothing inside the Louvre, just outside the Louvre.
Continue on from now till now. How did, like, you guys build your, like, little mini Rad empire?
Yeah, well, I mean, like that, right? once we started and we dropped that first album, I think it just, we started, like, making fans and stuff, and it was like, whoa, this is sick. And we really just hit the ground running, and we went and we toured in a minivan, like, months later, like, after we started, and just continued to tour and release projects and just, like, travel and play shows and make more songs. And, you know, now, like, 4 or 5 years later, now we're here, and we're about to drop a new EP and within the next month, and it's pretty crazy. It's awesome.
It's crazy. It's crazy to look back at all the years.
All the quesadillas.
All the quesadillas.
All the late night.
But we did it, you know, we essentially, like, we had a team, but we essentially did it ourselves. You know, we never had a label or anything backing us financially. We really grinded it out, as they say. You know, we would go on the road and find every way we could to help save money and make sure that we could continue to do it and sustain without starving.
Oh my god, it looked like that truck was about to fucking kill us. Okay, sorry.
Gosh, that would be crazy.
That's how you go, that's how it ends.
That's how it all ends.
It's the most epic interview ever.
I know, right? Dude. Independent California band dies during interview and we got it on film. That'd be viral.
Viral.
We've always talked about like killing one of our members off and then you know, like
it'd be, would you?
I think we should kill Josh.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because Josh is the most like publicly visible. Like he looks like a superstar. So when we kill him, just blow up.
Blow up, bro.
But of course he'll be alive. Yeah. He'll just be like in a dungeon.
Secretly kill.
I know, right? We're kind of kidding. We're not kidding.
We're Gangsta Paradise.
Huh? Talking about it on the way here, the song Radio, how you guys talk about how what it would be like in the future, but now you've come to that point, basically.
Yeah.
How do you feel looking back to that?
I'm going to tell you, hold on. We're going to start with the story of Radio, because it's so epic.
It is epic.
So, after we all met, they went back to L.A. They went back to the Bay. I was still living in New York. And then we got this job through Be Easy to go work on this film with a guy named Bruce Weber. And after the film, we decided to go meet with my friend Christian, aka Rexstar, and work with him on more music. And the inception of Radio was Big Red playing the only chords he knows how to play on a ukulele. And we used those, and we had the progression, and we went to Starbucks in Boca Raton, Florida, in Meisner Park. and we sat and wrote the song at a outside at a coffee, like a table at the coffee shop. And so that's the story of radio. That's some back the background of radio and how it started. I think when you're starting, I think it's such an I wouldn't say it's radio is a fan favorite song, would you?
No, I've never heard someone say it.
Yeah, and I mean
I guess way back, like in 2012, yeah. People said it, but like.
But I think it's, I think the beauty of the song is when you are an artist, the reality is, whether you're independent or trying to be a pop star or whatever kind of band you are, in some way, shape, or form, you have in the back of your head, like, I hope one day I get to hear myself. You know, and it's true. You know, you just think about that, and you wait for that day when you turn it on, or when you get the call and say, 9 p.m. tonight, Kiss FM, blah, 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 whatever, you know, so. I love that song. I forget about it sometimes. Yeah. Just because you have so many songs and it was so long.
You guys recorded it with like some
today. It's so shitty.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I had the greatest part about it. When I listened to that song, selfishly, I listened to myself. And, like, I didn't, at that point, I didn't know how to sing. And so, like, I remember just, like, trying to, like, sing and, like, and like now, after 6 years, we can all sing fucking perfectly. We could probably be like the fucking Beach Boys if you gave us a day. You know, like, singing is such an afterthought. But at that moment, I had never sung in my life. And I remember, like, trying so hard. And, like, we weren't, like, using auto-tune. And it was just, like, sounding like shit.
We also recorded it in a, literally, like, it was like a bedroom with, like, a sheet, like, covering it. Like,
yeah.
So funny.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Did you do anything long enough, you're gonna get good at it. That's how I feel about everything.
That's what's really cool about that first album is that we recorded it in like a week and it was like, yeah, this is awesome, let's do it, let's put it out. Like, you know, at that point we had known each other, we'd known Josh only for a few months really, like wasn't even a thing yet, and then it's such a cool snapshot of like the beginning of how we work together and how it sounds, and then
sleeping, you know, on couches, fucking
progressed and all that. And
that was such a magical time, dude. Like, just that, when the inception of Rad and that first project and how it all came together, even going through to when you guys officially like moved down to LA and you're crashing on Chelsea's couch and shit. Like, It was so real, so authentic. So, you know, I feel like bands rough it. That's the reality. Bands spend years working on their craft, years putting in time, making no money to try to get somewhere with it. And no matter how successful you get, I really believe that the most memorable times, the best times, are when you're not necessarily the biggest and you're struggling, but as a cohesive unit and a team with the same end goal. Those are the most special moments when you're doing this kind of stuff. And that's the reality. Like, we had no money, we had nothing going, dude. I'm from here, so I have my parents. They're sleeping on friends' couches. They're just, you know, trying to get by and make it work and record and put out music and build something. And those first couple years, though, man, like, touring in minivans, A-Mitch driving through the fucking night on Adderall.
That one, remember the one where we did
three shows in 24 hours?
Four shows in 24, wasn't it four shows?
I was talking about the one where we almost hit a deer. Remember that?
No, I almost killed us in,
you almost killed us.
Yeah, I thought, yeah.
This one was actually, I fell asleep at the wheel. I was driving because we had that. It was literally fell asleep.
We almost died 8 times in a car ride.
That was the worst. That was the worst travel we've ever had. That one you're talking about.
United lost our luggage.
Lost the drum.
They lost
cymbals.
No, United lost everything. That was the one everything. Yeah. We had to go to a guitar center and buy like $5,000 worth of new gear because United lost every single piece of our luggage.
6 a.m. flight out of L.A. Land in Boston.
To the East Coast.
Land in Boston. They lose all our shit. We get a rent-a-car. We have to go buy all the stuff from Guitar Center. Then we had a 2.5-hour drive to some college that we were playing. We were supposed to go on at 7 p.m. We didn't end up going on until 10 p.m. We get off stage.
Freezing.
We go hang out. It's freezing cold. It's like 20 degrees outside. The show was outdoors. Play the show, go get some Chinese food, hang out with some kids, and then, like, our flight's at 6 a.m. the next morning. So we had to drive 2.5 hours back to Boston to get on our flight.
And that's when we almost died.
Yeah, and that's when we almost died.
But
yeah. Yeah.
No, but then that was the one with A. Mitch was we played, it was Virginia. We had a show in Virginia.
Connecticut.
It was a
and
show
then
in
New
Virginia.
Jersey.
No, it was a show in Virginia that night. Left from the show, A. Mitch took an Adderall, drove straight through the night. We had a 10 a.m. sound check at UConn.
Yeah. Slept on Cammy's floor.
For like 2 hours. Played the show, packed up from that show, and then we had a show that night in Long Island.
And then that's when the speakers blew up.
And the speakers literally caught on flames. Like, literally caught on fire. Like,
yeah. Mid-show.
Mid-show. Vibe to this.
No.
Yeah. It was during Vibe to This,
the
dude.
Most non-fire song.
Dude, it was during Vibe to This. And literally, like, it's just, you know, like, in, like, smaller venues where there's, like, the monitors, like, there's, like, the speakers in front of the stage. There's, like, three of them across. That's so we can hear ourselves if you don't have in-ears. Literally, smoke started billowing out of it, and then all of a sudden it's just, and this, a flame pops out of the speaker in the middle of the show.
Yeah, we turned it off. It was like, hey, speakers are on fire. I was like, no, they're on fire.
No, they're
like,
literally on fire.
Yo, these speakers on fire, bud.
No, for real, though.
But yeah, okay. Done reminiscing.
Those were the best times, dude. Like, those were like, that was incredible.
Talk all you want.
It was funny. I had drinks last night with Jack Shannon from Recess. Recess is like this college experiential agency, touring company, whatever, and we were just going so deep in music and talking about all this shit. He said to me, he's like, what are like, when inside of Radical Something were like the moments that you guys were like, we can do this, or, oh wow, we have fans, or how, or we made it. Never felt like you made it. You never feel like you really made it. Never, never feel like that. But like, and I said to him, as I told him.
I have two guesses. Either the No Sweat drop or the one, or the Sundown video.
Sundown.
Yeah.
It was Sundown. I was Sundown. I'm going to tell you the story.
That's a great video too.
I'll tell you the whole story of Sundown. The full blunt story that's like not going to leave anything out. So, we're in the Bay. We're staying at Mikey's parents' house. And we start the song. Mikey makes the beat. Start the song. I sing the chorus. And we're like, let's shoot a music video. But Loggy didn't write his shit yet to the song. But either way, we were going to Berkeley, where they went to college. And we had our video guy, Joe, busy with us. And we were like, let's shoot a song. So we get some friends there from college. And we have, it's like, it's literally to this day, my favorite Radical Something video. Like, it's just so important to me. It was so authentic and real and such a lovely day in general. So we shoot the video, obviously, if you've seen it, I don't know. But like, so we shoot the video. And Joe Busy's editing the video, but Loggy didn't write his stuff yet. And so, like, Loggy, like, can't write, and he's writing some stuff, and, like, thought it sucked, and then he wrote some more stuff, and Red thought it sucked, and then, like, Loggy and I went to his grandma's house, sat in the backyard, wrote again, and then it was good. And then, but mind you, in between all of this, literally, like, there was points where I thought we were gonna break up, because, like, it was getting so frustrating, and Loggy was getting so mad, and, like, everybody was freaking out about these verses. And so, finally, we get it right at Loggy's grandma's house. We go cut it. We didn't have a mixing engineer, so we sent the files to Zach Gurka in New York to mix it. Shittiest mix ever, but at the same time, like, kind of what gave the song its, like, character. Just how he mixed the song and arranged it and shit. And then we put it out. So we put just the music video out. And it did okay. Like, it was kind of like, whatever, you know? But then Loggy had a brilliant idea of saying we should, for the holidays, give the fan. Was it Christmas or Thanksgiving?
Thanksgiving.
So he said, for Thanksgiving, we'll give the fans a gift, like a free MP3 download. And we got Nick from This Song Is Sick to premiere it, and he posted the music video and the exclusive free download link. And then Nick, being the guy he is, just like forgot to post anything on This Song Is Sick for like 4 days. So it just sat at the top of the page, which at the time it was like one of the biggest music discovery platforms ever, and the song, it was the first time I ever saw virality happen, like, to a fan base. I remember we went and played Colorado shows after that, every show was sold out, and it was like, I was like, oh, like, we did something, you know. It was the first time I, like, was like, we can do this, guys, we can do, you know, I felt, yeah. I was like, wow, we can really do this, like, we have, you know, someone likes it.
I guess it can go together, like, your guys' most important moral for the band, like, what you guys are swearing, like, we're gonna keep being humble, keeping whatever, and how it feels, because I know it's obviously your music, you have a lot of California culture in it, it's really beach vibey, California music. How do those two go together and have, like, basically what's the morale of the band? What's the spirit of the band?
We keep on being easy, man.
Be easy. You want to answer that, Loggy?
I mean, I feel like in my eyes, like, the morals are like... I think we're good. Oh, you're good.
Happy right now.
In my eyes,
I just say I'm super happy.
In my eyes, the morals that I try to stick to are, I think a lot of artists or bands get lost in what they want when they realize that half of their life should be about what the people in their fan base want, and not like we're playing to fans or making changes, but I think specifically I like roughly finding that happy space where we can create what we want, but with always knowing that what we're making is for people that love and support us, and we need to cater to them as much as possible. That can be sonically, that can be visually, that can be just reaching out to people. I think a lot of what we did was we were on the cusp of when social media became really one-to-one, where you can reach out to Incubus and Brandon Boyd might write you back. Like, that is like when we started. So that's always been very important to us. And the California thing is just natural. It's like, I live a fucking block from the beach. What the fuck am I gonna do? Wear a suit on the sand? It's like, all I do is, like, you know, drink 40s on the beach and write music. Like, literally, that's what we've been doing for so long. So, you know, that's kind
of
cool.
Yeah, just to piggyback off of that, I think realizing that we built this based off of fans, one fan at a time, is super important, because that's why we are where we are. It was never radio. It was friends spreading the word about the music and the culture and what we were kind of preaching, I guess you would say. And I think we've always done a really great job of, you know, giving the fans everything we can, you know, making sure that the fans understand that we, like, appreciate, you know, all the support that they've given us to make sure we can continue even making music.
We love the favorite. I send it to him, be like, look, they like me better than you. Yep. I remember the day that you followed me on Instagram, or one of my Instagram accounts, I screenshot it, sent to him like 10 times in a row. I was like, look it. Check it out.
Loggy's about to slide into my DMs.
He said that actually when the day I told him, I was like,
don't worry.
Don't be jealous.
Off limits.
Okay, the last couple of questions that would just be like fun-ish questions. Because, like I said, the publication that I write for is really BuzzFeed style. Like, it's college only. This one's a lame one, but I'm gonna ask it.
Go for it.
Bottom one. Favorite pizza topping and why?
And why? Pepperoni. I mean, pepperoni and sausage is just what I ate when I grew up. Red? Go quick. This is rapid fire. This is BuzzFeed.
I'm a vegetarian, so no meat. Maybe some veggies.
I like you said maybe.
Josh?
I mean, dude, like, pepperonis, I guess. But, like, remember that time when we had the show in Chicago and we went to the kid's house and ordered, like, 10 deep dish pizzas?
Yeah, I threw up.
Yeah! That'll be college for you.
Yes! Go-to weapon for a zombie apocalypse.
Go-to weapon?
Oh, shit.
Like, do we have to have it in? Do we have to have it in our possession? Or, like, is it, like, machine gun, even if I don't have one?
Well, how much ammo are you going to bring with you, bro?
It's, like, let's say unlimited ammo, unlimited anything, but you for sure have this at all times. So, like, you would not lose it. You just attain it.
I feel like I'd kind of be an axe-wielding type character. Like, I'd have that axe, and I'd chunk it, pull it. I'd just, like, neck. I would just, like, cave in people's faces.
Yeah, battle
axe. You're that character in Skyrim.
Dude, yeah.
Definitely have a sniper rifle.
Josh thinks about this for sure.
Dude, I always think, I mean, I'm obsessed with Walking Dead, and I always think, like, how and if I could survive in the apocalypse.
I'll tell you, no, you wouldn't.
Yes, I could. I could survive.
Josh, they don't make quesadillas when the apocalypse hits.
I'd be the fucking mayor.
Okay. Kill me, cocktail. Right.
First of all,
I do, like, prep for zombies. Like, I have, like, maps and shit.
Yeah. Good.
You guys are weird.
That's smart, man.
I'm going straight to the harbor. I'm stealing a boat. I already thought it.
Interesting.
Favorite memories of the band?
Favorite memories.
Favorite memories. really like, and Josh wasn't involved in this one, but what I always think about is we had this show in Utah and we just crushed this massive outdoor show in this college, and then we broke it. Me, you, and Alex, Mr. Hart broke into this hotel pool and hot tub with a bunch of tall cans.
Yeah.
And we just got wasted in the hot tub, and it was like beautiful, and we just kind of hung out and just like we're like, dude, we're fucking doing it.
Yeah, there's all sorts of breaking.
I don't
in
even remember that
hotel
show.
Pools. I think.
It was a college show.
College show in Utah. Lance's brother got it for us.
Yeah. Oh wait, growing up and playing up there might be like the weirdest, coolest thing ever.
You see that?
Remember when we went up?
That was
Utah,
on footage
we
too.
The music video.
You see that?
Remember when we went up?
That
in
was
Utah,
on footage
we
too.
Did the music video?
About?
Yeah, it was that show.
But this awesome. Is a whole different thing, though. We stacked up, they stacked up a bunch of pillars, lit it on fire, and there's like 50 people, and then we did a video.
It was like forever.
It was like forever video. Yeah.
That was a good video, too.
Yeah, we liked
They're
that
all
one.
Great
yeah.
Josh, favorite memory?
The Maryland show.
Which one?
You know what's actually really fun I never think about? Fashion Week, the first time we played in New York. We stayed in New York like one of the first times we started playing stuff, and it was like the first like Drake we were playing next door like let's fuck.
Did I not send you guys Snapchats when I was drinking there in New York the other day at the Standard in the beer garden?
No.
Crushing
yeah,
beers.
No, you did.
No. Just like
recently.
Just when I was in New York.
I was like, they didn't have Snapchat.
And I was just looking. I was like, I cannot believe we played this place. Like, we must have been fucking.
That Arizona show, the Flagstaff show. That was one of my favorite memories.
When I fell off stage.
Yeah.
We get to
soundcheck. There's nobody there.
Yeah.
And we're like, fuck, this is gonna be whack. And then like we go on like way out later in the night. So we went and took a nap, and like we walked over this hill. And there's like thousands of kids. We're like, oh, this is gonna be sick. It was like one of the most lit shows we ever played.
Yeah, it was the most lit
ever. I think Maryland was more lit, but
Maryland.
That one was more.
Baltimore.
On the Cruella
tour. The first one? Oh, I thought the one where we broke
Logic
the floor when we were jumping in Maryland, our first sellout ever.
Yeah,
Maryland.
That was fun too. Dude, there's so many fucking memories. I like literally like. Go think about it. Think of the three of us for fucking 5 years, touring half the year in minivans, buses, and hundreds
planes,
of cities.
Planes
shit's gonna happen.
Planes,
shit's gonna get weird, you know? Like, you're gonna have all these really awesome memories. There's like a million fond memories that I have.
The
know?
Worst part is I forget so much.
Yeah. I know, but the good thing is we have a hard drive with fucking probably like 10 months of fucking footage to look back on.
So I throw it in the Pacific to make sure no one ever gets to see it.
Foggy, don't do that.
I think the one
of
you falling off the stage has become viral in the community, so.
I fucking hope so. We should put some money into that.
I shared it, and then I FaceTimed them and watched it.
It's so good. It was a bailout for the fucking, for the ages, for sure.
I like how they kept going. They kind of just looked at me like
that. Dude, that, and notice.
Yeah, everyone just stopped. Just didn't even care.
Josh just
whatever.
And Brad's like. I mean, that was my entrance. That's what you don't realize. That was my entrance.
Show,
so like, that when you first see me, that's me walking side stage. That's the first thing I did was eat shit in front of 3,000 people.
So let me tell you what. Now I'm gonna tell you that.
Remember when you fell
off the stage in New Jersey when we jumped off the Cruella show? I was like standing on this fucking speaker and it just collapsed and I fucking backflopped on the ground.
That one he actually got hurt on though.
Yeah, I still have a bruise.
Yeah.
I think I still have, it's never left me. It never
bruised
it
never left.
I don't know.
Is it like still tender? Like when it's cold outside?
No, it's just black. It's like this black, I think it might be closer to
dead
my booty.
Just chilling there.